Facebook or Twitter or Pinterest, my index finger is immediately poised for scrolling. Like, I'm ready to just sift through. I'm ready for each individual post to be mostly ignored. I'll give it, like, you know, a second of attention. Once in a while, I'll stop and actually read something. I think what we're seeing now is the rise of a new model where people decide in advance that they want to hear everything that one person has to say. They want to hear from particular people again and again, rather than counting on the algorithm to surface the most engaging content from various feeds. So you're seeing that with Clubhouse. When you join a Clubhouse room, you're committing to sort of listen to whatever those people have to say for a little while. Of course, you can leave anytime, but you're giving them your full attention, or at least part of your attention. And the same with super follows on Twitter. The idea is that there are certain people you follow that you don't just want to count on the algorithm to show you one of their tweets once in a while. You want to actually really pay and be a member of the community with them, where you're counting on them to deliver stuff that you're interested in reliably.
But Will, I think it's worth noting here that, you know, you mentioned the community on Clubhouse, but really this is about content more than it is about social networks. You know, Facebook was established to keep up with your network of friends. Even Instagram, people may follow plenty of people and companies they don't know, but there is this idea that you get to keep up with friends across the country. What you're talking about now is much more about content and people willing to pay to have a direct relationship with content creators rather than actually about a social network of people that may or may not know each other in real life, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. I mean, for a long time, we were counting on these social networks to also be our source for digital content. And I think we're seeing a little bit of a separation between those two, where you have platforms like Substack, you have Patreon, and then you have it within the social networks as well, like the Twitter super follows, the Twitter spaces, YouTube Premium, where you can pay to subscribe to somebody. We're seeing a new way of connecting with the people who produce the content you want to see, rather than just getting that from your friends on a social network. I think one of the reasons for that is because we've learned over time that the content that Facebook and Twitter and algorithms surface for us tends to be polarizing, tends to be divisive, it tends to be sensational. It's very good at hooking our attention, but it gets exhausting. It's like, it's, you know, when every post that you see in your feed is the post that has been chosen from thousands of possible posts to be the most engaging, most likely to make people click or like or share. It's just tiring, and I think we're looking at a little bit of a pullback where people are wanting to trust a few certain sources with information again and again, rather than just getting the post that has the most likes every time that they refresh the feed.
Yeah, Will, it kind of reminds me of the transition that we saw in news from just linear news to more newsletter-based subscriptions. I do wonder, though. Are you a firm believer that we'll find, as this new model evolves, good externalities on misinformation and harassment in general?
I think there are going to be upsides and downsides. I mean, you look at Clubhouse as an example. We've already seen how it can be used for harassment. There are rooms that are formed on Clubhouse specifically to target a certain person that people don't like, and they can get together and plot ways to brigade or harass that person on social media. The moderation on those rooms has not been very good so far on Clubhouse's part. At the same time, you know, on Clubhouse, you are choosing to go into a room based on who the speakers are usually. So at least there's that initial decision that's intentional on the part of the user that I want to see information from this person. I want to be part of this room. That's a little different than social media feeds that will make a given post from somebody you've never heard of go viral and put that at the top of your feed. So I think that the amplification problem is less serious on a platform like Clubhouse. We don't have to worry as much about something like, you know, Russian interference on a platform like Clubhouse, because, again, you're choosing the relationship with the people whose room you want to be in. So, you know, and as far as misinformation, I think there's tons of misinformation on Clubhouse, just like there's misinformation when people talk to each other in real life. People gather around the water cooler. It's very hard to track. It's hard to stamp out. But at the same time, it's not as permanent, and maybe the effects are not as great when you don't have an algorithm showing that misinformation to millions of people.
Shepard Smith here. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube.